everybody. How are we doing today? Good? Woo! Good to hear. Like she just said, my name is J.D. Reinbott. I currently work down at Keys Marine Lab in Layton, Florida. And today I'm going to be talking with you all a little bit more about Florida's pillar coral population decline and the corresponding genetic rescue project that stemmed in response to this. Today I'm actually speaking on behalf of my boss and supervisor, Cynthia Lewis. She unfortunately could not be here today. Her daughter is getting married, so kind of a very good reason to miss Reef Futures. But I would be remiss if I did not mention that this whole rescue project was the culmination of work of multiple individuals and organizations, including that of Cindy, but also Karen Neely, Carrie O'Neill, and Jennifer Moore. So huge shout out to all of them. As we kind of dive into this, I wanted to take a moment to initially kind of set up the stage of what Florida's DSIL population originally used to look like. Looking back in 2013 and 2015, it was found that these corals had a rather fragmented population. There were few colonies throughout the entirety of the Southern Florida region, and they were widely scattered. We also found that there was a very low genetic diversity amongst this species. There was usually only one genotype per site. And as we all kind of know with the story of this coral, there has been a high rate of decline in terms of disease and bleaching events. Again, showing what that initial baseline looked like back in 2013 and 2014 as our team was chasing the last unicorns, as I like to call them, based on the way that they grow and also because they are extremely hard to find. It was found that there was roughly 842 different colonies that were spread out across 167 different sites, and you can see where all of those were laying throughout the Southern Florida region, and there were roughly 200 genotypes in total. As I've kind of already alluded to, most of these sites only had one to two colonies on them, and again, only one set genotype. There were a few outliers, more specifically five sites, that had more than 20 colonies on them, but again, it was still that one set genotype, or otherwise known as being clonal. Now, this is really important to mention because it led to researchers having a false sense of what the population of these corals actually looked like, more specifically within their genetic makeup. As we all know, this coral has been on the decline. In 2008, it was added to the IUCN Red List, and in 2014, it was added to the US Federal Endangered Species Act, listed as threatened. And unfortunately, now out on our reefs, this coral is quintessentially extinct in the wild. Now, a lot of people like to ask, well, what's actually contributing to this decline? And we can attribute this to a multitude of different stressors and reasons. The first of which being two major mass bleaching events that took place throughout the entirety of Florida's coral reef. The first of which being in summer of 2014, the second roughly a year later, transforming a beautiful reef like this in this picture to a rather stark white comparison. But in addition to this, we are also seeing things like white plague, black band disease, and our not so favorite friend, stony coral tissue loss disease. Now, I have an asterisk next to Skittles because this is arguably the most detrimental of all of these stressors to this coral. The disease itself, as we have all kind of heard, affects 20 plus different coral species, but DSIL is arguably the most susceptible to this. Helping set the stage, I know we've been talking about stony coral tissue loss a lot today, but in case you missed it, it was first kind of documented back in February of 2016 up in Biscayne Bay, and it rapidly spread throughout the entirety of the Florida reef system, found down in the Dry Tortugas in May of 2021. Now, that may only seem like roughly 5 years, and you say, hey, that's a very, you know, long time, but in the grand scheme of things, that is the blink of an eye. And it's really important to also mention that stony coral tissue loss was not actually defined until 2018. So as researchers were seeing this progress throughout the Florida region, they weren't entirely sure of what was actually happening. To kind of show what this has looked like, a beautiful image made by Karen Neely. Hi, Karen, I see you in the back. Showing what that decline looked like, again, with those two initial bleaching events in 2014 and 2015, and then stony coral tissue loss disease hitting rapidly and showing that overall decline of percentage original tissue in those corals over a period of time. And to further drive this point home, we can see what this decline has looked like in terms of a physical map. There's a lot of different data points you can see on this image, but I want you to focus on the green, which is live, red, which is stony coral tissue loss disease, and then black, which is dead. And as we click through this very fun image, you can see this rapid progression of stony coral tissue loss disease and those corals unfortunately dying and ending in the most recent picture. So it's very clear that this is a race against time, and something needed to be done to help protect and conserve these corals. The initial proposed solution for this was to create a living ark, and you can see our unicorns patiently waiting to get on that ark. And this whole process initially started with the collection of pillars of opportunities, otherwise known as poos. With this process, researchers were originally going out and finding broken off fragments of these corals. Pillar coral itself normally asexually fragments, so breaks off and rolls on the reef, and researchers were going and looking for those individual fragments. They were collecting them and then transporting them back to land-based facilities where they were held and quintessentially taken care of. However, there were some initial issues and bumps along the way. The biggest thing to mention is a lot of these sites that researchers were going to had corals that were already too stressed. You can see in that image right there a very significantly bleached pillar. And with those collections that were then brought back on land, a lot of them unfortunately did not make it. In addition to this, we also were able to see that researchers could not originally trim dead or dying portions of the skeleton from these fragments. So still having that stressor that is impacting the live component or living tissue of that coral, again, eventually leading to its demise. So we all found that poos were not enough. The team worked with the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary to start actively harvesting from these colonies themselves. So again, previously they were going out and finding off those broken fragments. Now researchers were actually going and harvesting directly from those colonies. These collections were first done across two major rescue blitzes, the first taking place in summer 2016, and the second in spring of 2017. And you can see that a wide array of fragments and also genotypes were collected. It's really important to mention that with this collection process, it was a quintessential Herculean effort. There were multiple organizations and collaborative agencies that were all working together to go out and collect these fragments and bring them back to land, again, to work to save this species. At the end of those two rescue blitzes, it was found that roughly 680 fragments were collected, and you can see where those various collection sites were from. However, I want to let you all know that that collection process did not simply just stop with those rescue blitzes. Collections have continued opportunistically throughout 2021, including regions like that of the Dry Tortugas and Biscayne National Park. Now, with that collection process kind of coming to a close, per se, a lot of individuals like to ask, well, at the end of the day, what is the success of this rescue project? And one of the biggest things to mention is we were able to finally determine the husbandry needs for this species. With this rescue attempt and this rescue process, beforehand, there had never been documented cases of having this coral in land-based facilities. And due to this project and these rescue attempts, we are now able to understand what these corals need to be kept and held on land. But in addition to this, we can also talk about the fact that these corals are the reason why antibiotic treatments were developed. Sit with that for a moment. These corals quintessentially changed the game for the coral rescue processes that we use today to help combat stony coral tissue loss disease. These fragments led to the first indication that antibiotic treatments would work and also led to the development of the first pastes. And we can also see that these fragments were used in land-based spawning efforts throughout 2016 up to 2022. Focusing in a little bit closer, looking up at Florida Aquarium, the team up at FLAC has been able to induce spawning every year from 2019 to 2022, again, using these fragments that were collected. And while they do have varying fertilization rates, anywhere from 20% to 100, obviously getting something to recruit and spawn on land does take a lot of time and effort, they are seeing these gametes come together and lead to the creation of new recruits. And that is leading to the mixing of overall genetic diversity. As I mentioned a few slides ago, some of the corals that were collected were found down in Dry Tortugas National Park and other ones up in, let's say, Biscayne Bay. In a natural setting, those corals would never see each other. And more importantly, those gametes would never see each other. But due to these rescue efforts, those gametes are now coming together. And we are seeing that this arc is successful. It is quintessentially producing the biomass that will eventually be the seed stock for restoration efforts in the future when it is time to put these recruits back out on the reef. And as we all know, with this new genetic diversity, we are seeing increased overall genetic diversity. A more genetically diverse species is a more resilient species to help combat and deal with different stressors like different diseases, global warming, and all the other super fun things that we love to deal with as restoration practitioners. And with that, as I come to a close, I just want to give a huge shout out to the multiple agencies and individuals who played a part in this process, all the different permitting organizations, the project funding, and then of course all the partners who were physically out in the water collecting these fragments, but also helping to take care of them while they were back on land. And also a very big, huge shout out to Cindy, Karen, Carrie, and Jen for trusting me with telling this story. If any of you have any questions, I will do my best to answer them, but I can also give you contact info for Cindy, as she is a great resource. And as I come to a close, I will say that I am number 59 if anyone is looking for their drink buddy.